Streets of Jerusalem are still shouting the name. Hosanna, Hosanna. Looking for the Savior, they say, Hosanna. Save us, we pray, is what it means. Save us, we pray, Lord. Century after century, we keep shouting that name. And now the name is finally becoming love. Now the name is finally become love. Church after church in this city are rising up today, offering praise to the name of Jesus. Every place on this earth that's meant to be alive in the spirit will make a sound just like you and me. Will this city be silent, or will it shout the name? Will this church remain quiet, or will there be praise to his name? Will there be street, Jesus Christ is alive inside of me, and I'm bound to praise the name. Are we alive, or are we just a praising sound? Are we the way God intended us, or are we just looking around to be blessed more than before? As for me, I'm looking to praise my Lord. I'm old enough now to not have a future, so I've got nothing to worry about. Some of you are still young and your hearts are caught up by what you believe might be coming. And your fear of where you've lost keeps controlling a future of the cost. That Jesus is the God of now. He's the God of your past and your future. But his name is I Am. That means I'm right here next to you. Better not be worried about what you're gonna be, 'cause time keeps changing that. Just start getting in touch with the God of right now. The healing is right there, waiting there. And many of you are already healed, but you don't really know it. And he's answered prayers much more than you know, but you're living inside of something else. So come here and know the God of I Am will not be turning away, for he calls you to say, follow me and do it now today. God is making something different than he's ever done before. He's calling a generation to cry out, I love you, Lord. For centuries we've not said these words together. We've said he's wonderful, we said that he's kind, and we said that he's full of glory. But we seldom say, I love you, with lost in the fear of who. So who can love someone that you don't know? So it's time to know the King, who longs to hold your hand and bless you with the prophet of his living. So we are the ones of destiny's call, the peculiar people waiting for our Lord to call, trying to live a life as quietly as we can, and yet we've got to praise you, a Savior, going through the streets, and we're shouting Hosanna again. Palm branches on the streets, our cloaks of value on the ground, and the donkey that carries his presence is about to carry it again somehow. And Ishmael, his name is known as an ass, and that's who's gonna carry the burden through the past. And one day you'll see Ishmael carrying Jesus Christ through the streets of Jerusalem, and it might happen tonight. Can we know the mystery of something we can't be? For God alone can change the mind of all destiny. And I can't wait to see it be the wonder of my Savior in me. Alleluia, alleluia, glory to your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're never gonna be the same. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, even heaven shouts it out. Oh, worthy is the Lamb of God to be glorified right now. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, we offer praise to you. Outstretched arms and broken lives, we worship one like you. Oh, Jesus cannot be stopped as his heart is filled with glory, and our lives will offer endless praise to the one who calls you holy. Holy as I am, he said that's what we'll be. I always struggle with that truth. But it's not my goodness that will make me holy. It's the righteousness of Christ inside of me and you. And now I accept this awesome gift, and the blood will not be in vain. As we learn to lift up one matchless name in hope, thousand years ago, the disciples tried to be a world full of righteousness. What a destiny! Only the example of Jesus Christ, and now him ascended to the throne, left with the task of changing the entire world and giving them the light that never stops glowing. Oh God, still we wonder how to be full of Christ in all and time, to be in destiny. But now we look for what we cannot see, gather the faith of the Church of Christ that lives in true destiny. Reminded me the other day, there's still power in the blood. There's still glory that's yet to be seen in that power from above. And in your veins flows the blood of Christ, no matter how much you try to deny. So lifting voices, lifting lives up to Him, you'll see power you cannot deny. And He said, you are my servants, but now I call you my friend. And all I'm doing in this earth, I'll keep you posted throughout all of them. But now it's time to walk in the wonder that only God gave one man. And now it's spread out through billions of souls, and there's still a billion more to come in. Let your spirit rise, and let your glory be known, as we finally accept the person of Christ in the life He's in our lives alone. And I would say it's time to be a born again Church of Christ that lives out its true destiny.
There's a lot in the spirit in this house that makes it easy to listen to God. The best thing that can ever happen to anybody who ministers here is to be able to hear God. That makes sense?
Yes.
You can be blessed, but that doesn't really mean anything if you can't hear God, does it? So I can tell you a whole bunch of really cool things, but if I'm not hearing God, then this is just cool things, you know. There are some things that are really brewing in your midst. I'm sure you know that, but I've been pondering a word, or kind of a word to bring or give, or I don't know what to say about it. You know, I'd love to say that I'm prophetic all the time, but I'm not. I'm just, I'm a servant all the time, but occasionally that becomes prophetic. And I think God is changing how we have approached that. We've had lots of prophecies, isn't that correct? How many have ever had a prophetic word spoken over you? How many have had those prophetic words come to pass? It's pretty amazing, isn't it, when He begins to do this. So, how many would like to have a prophetic word spoken over you? Would that be something? I may need to wait for the translation. Should I move slower? Everybody okay with how fast I'm going? You can raise your hand, or you can say, no, I don't understand. You can say anything you like, but it's... There's something we can, well, I'll see how this goes. I'll try something, and if it really feels terrible, I'll quit. There's something that's been happening to us as a people all over the world, and it is, as God is raising up a praise in this hour that's different than praise in any hour in history. This is the first time in history that we as a people have actually offered to God the words, I love you. Did you know that? Did you know? You didn't know that. Did you know that there's only once in the entire Bible that someone says voluntarily, I love you, God? That's in Psalm 18, first verse. David said it. I love you, Lord. Isn't that interesting? Did you know it's not written anywhere else in the scripture? Until Jesus gets Peter by the head and says, hey, do you love me? That's the only other time. That's the only other time that that word, I love you, is spoken. And he was hesitant to even speak it then. And he wasn't really, I love you, I'm committed, I will, you know, nothing's going to shake me. He was saying, you know, I'm really emotionally attached to you. How many know that being emotionally attached is not what the Lord is referring to? We are not going to be able to be emotionally attached to Christ and make it through this. We have to be committed to Jesus Christ. And your love for him will create a greater and greater commitment. I mean, why does a husband not cheat on his wife? He loves her. It isn't because he's a great guy. Am I talking to the right? Is this the right crowd for this sort of talk? It isn't because we're wonderful people. It is because the love causes my commitment to be strong, not my goodness. Does that make sense? And so without that love, you can't actually obey the Lord. Scripture even says so. If you love me, you'll obey me. Later it says, if you don't love me, even if you try to obey me, it doesn't work. So there has to be something in it. And we're the first, and it's only about 40 years old that praise has included the words, I love you. Anybody know that? Even the hymns of our time don't say that. His loving kindness is wonderful. He's a great God. He's holy. He's one. He is all those things. Nothing is wrong with that. But you know, when you're in a love affair, sooner or later, you want someone to say, I love you. I really love you. This relationship has caught my heart, and I can't let go of you. How about that? Isn't that interesting? Why now? Why not 1840? Why not 1620? Why now is this happening? Can you imagine? Can you possibly? I mean, you guys probably have better ideas than I do now. I just can't get over how much God has not changed his mind concerning his love for me, and yet I'm still struggling with how to love him. Anybody there? When I first got saved, of course, the first thing I heard is, now love the Lord thy God with all your heart and all your mind. I'm like, I don't even know God. I just know I'm a mess. That's all I know. And he's supposedly going to save me. Isn't that correct? I'm just trying to get real about it. Just, you know, I think he's going to save me. Yes, he is going to save you. When? Well, it's going to take a little time for you to realize he has saved you. You're probably going to have to get a glimpse of hell to know what you are saved from. Right? Does it mean anything if you don't know the mess you are in or could have been in? I mean, do you feel saved? I feel saved. I know where I was. When I got saved, I started to feel saved pretty fast. And then in a year, I was like, whoa, I'm really saved. And then in 10 years, oh, my God, I'm really saved. You know, your life is such a mess. You realize, oh, man, I have no idea how much he saved me from. And then time started to break out inside of me. It's like, I can't stop, but I cannot not praise him. I can't stop myself from praising him because this is more than a gift. This is more than good. This is above good. This is, oh my God, isn't it? Does that make anybody strange, you know? I've often, you know, I have a lot of questions in my small thinking. I wonder, what the heck is this all about? And why did we do this? Why are we doing that? You know, and God's pretty patient with me. He only answers with questions. Does that happen to anybody? Like he needs an answer from me. And so he always asks my favorite, Lord, what does this mean? He said, what do you think it means? Because somehow he wants me and you to find him and dig through every word. That's why I heard earlier, you know, the pastor talking about the revival of the Bible. Isn't that a word? That's like, whoa, that's great. That is really, really your bottom line. That's a word. You have to just keep eating it. You know what I mean? Keep swallowing. And then look at the reasons. Why did Paul say something to the Romans he didn't say to the Colossians? Why did he say something to the Corinthians he didn't say to the Thessalonians? You know, was that more? Because he didn't know that anyone would be reading. These are letters. These are private letters. Why? So I got a lot of those questions. And, of course, God is, why do you think? And I'm always pondering the question of it. And once, and I may never forget this, I was praying for a young girl that I knew her family real well, and she was dying of cancer, and I felt she should be healed, Lord, and he wasn't disagreeing with that, but she died. And I was very upset. 100 people were praying for her 24/7, and it was a struggle. Anybody had one of those struggles? And I was like, God, what are you doing? What are you doing? And he said, do you love me? Isn't that a funny thing to ask? The last time that question was asked, God was preparing someone to feed his sheep, wasn't he? So I was like, why are you asking? I figured I'd try that trick on him, you know. And he kept saying, if you want my love to be unconditional, then why is yours? And I realized that I am good with God as long as he's doing what I want. And as long as he's fulfilling my needs, I'm good with him. I'm real good with him. What happens when it's not happening? How loud is my praise now? You see? So I tried this next new trick. I tried praising him even more, even though I did not understand what he was doing and didn't agree with it. Didn't agree. Did he call you to agree? He actually didn't call any of us to agree. He called us to unity. He didn't. He figured we wouldn't get that one. We don't agree. I don't agree with myself, so how can I possibly agree with someone else? But he says clearly, I've called you into unity, an unbreakable bond of love between each other, no matter what you agree with. And so I thought, I don't understand what you're doing, Lord. And he was so kind in letting me be that foolish. Anybody? I should have known this. I should have had that answer. But I didn't. So something's moving in all of us. And it's called the deep abiding love of Christ that's starting to well up inside of you that makes you offer I love yous without any question, without a hardship. It's written in our songs now. Our young people are saying it very regularly. But he's a serious God, and he takes that statement very seriously. And if you say, I love you, there's probably going to have to be some action that follows that up. You can't say, I love you to your wife and never treat her that way. Is that correct? There's going to have to be some fulfilling of these statements, but this is the first time in history that he has required it of us. Amazing. Think about this. Think about what this time really, really means. This is the time when the sound of I love you will pull at the heart of a father. Pull at that heart so strong, he will tear down hell itself to reach the sound. Am I making sense? And when we begin to offer this in the praise, like I heard today, it's beautiful praise in here. Is that real common for here? Do you guys have that? Think about how blessed you are that this sound is ringing through this room week after week. Think about this. At that heart of God is in the hearts of you that would shout so loudly to your God so freely without someone, come on, begging, without somebody begging you. It's just there in your heart. It's there that's willing to be offered. It's there to move without Jesus having you say, do you love me? Do you see what I mean? You don't have to ask us that anymore, Father. We love you. We love your Son. We love what you've done. We love what you are doing, and we love what you're about in us. And more so, we're growing in that love. Is that making sense to you? At the same time, it's probably important to know that we have an adversary. I like to focus on Jesus. I don't like to focus on the adversary. He's too boring. But there's things that we have to pay attention to, and we're coming to a time when we have to know the strategy of the enemy so that God will reveal that strategy. He's very good at this. He's very good at understanding and bringing us to a place of saying, stand here, the enemy will flee. Resist the devil, he will flee. You remember that? That has a lot to do with the word ignore. Now, ignore doesn't mean it isn't happening. It means don't let this distraction affect you. So I've got my Savior talking to me, and I got this screaming going on over here. You got some choice. Shut up, or just look at this face. Just look at the beauty of what Christ is doing. And today, when you guys were talking about it, what's really being said in Deuteronomy is he is saying, it's explaining what born again really means. That's what this means. I'm no longer thinking from this perspective. I'm thinking from here. That's what born again actually means. So when I'm living in fear, oh my God, my life, my money, my stuff, I'm not thinking from here. I'm thinking right from here. This is what the enemy wants me to live. Is that correct? So I don't live up here. I live down here. I'd like to be up here, but I'm down here, you know. Now, the Lord's offering us some assistance. Anybody think we could use a little assistance on getting up to that next born again? I even wrote a song about it called Born Again Again. You know, I want to be born again as many times as I need to until I am not thinking from here, but I'm from here. And Jesus was speaking to Nicodemus, a ranking officer, if you will, in the church. So he was speaking to the church. You must be born again or you won't see the kingdom of God. And Jesus was standing right in front of him. Here I am, God's purpose on earth, right in front of you, and you don't see me. That's why born again is very important for us. The world's going to get saved. We have to get born again, and our Bible has to have a revival. That's really the truth. Does anybody? We know all of it. And so it starts with my deep abiding love for Jesus and not being afraid to say so. Does anybody have that? I know back east where life is a lot rougher back there than it is out here in nice California. But back east, you know, men don't stand around and say, I love you. You know, they're men. And especially in the South, the United States, that's not very manly. And we don't, you know, to really, in tears, hold your face up to God and say, I love you deeply from your heart is a hard thing for strong men. Anybody? Very hard for strong men, but that's exactly who God is calling to his side. I'm going to take your strong men, and I'm going to break them to make them truly strong as lovers of Christ in a deep, abiding way. Does that make sense? All that's on us. It's not coming anymore. It's on us now, and it's been here for more than 40 years. One of the earliest songs was, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. Remember that? To worship you,
Oh, my soul, rejoice. You remember that? Isn't that great? And just saying, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Rejoice, my King, in what you hear. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound.
Does I love you sound good to you when you hear it? What do you think it means to the King of the universe when a people lift up their voice and just simply say, I love you, Jesus. My heart is broken for you. I love you. I don't have good reasons. I just do. I don't even have holy reasons. I just do. I can't even figure out why I'm overwhelmed by this. Is that right? Do you think you can explain why you love your husband or your wife? Oh, the way they comb their hair, yeah. You know what I mean. And I know for me, that's less effort these days. And so, what is it that it calls us into that deep abiding place? All right, and I'll be very, very fast. I have a very quick, maybe upsetting message to you, but get over it. It'll be fun. And I've been giving this message to musicians mostly, and I don't, but I think somehow, because you are a praising church, you need to hear this just as a little bit. There's going to be changes up here, as you well know, that God is moving through the house. In this room was full of the power of the presence of God as I was hearing praise today. Is it getting past that door? And that's what's going to happen. The Lord's going to start putting it past this door. Now, we keep thinking, well, get me a place to play in the world. I've tried this a few thousand times. He's not interested in us trying to find a place in the world to play. He's not trying to find a way to interrupt the world. He's trying to overwhelm it. He's not going to stop what the enemy is doing. He's going to overwhelm it. It's called overshadow is the key word. And when Jesus was standing there, it said the Holy Spirit overshadowed him. And there is even prayer about it. There's overshadow me, living God. I don't need visitation. I need to be overshadowed. I need to be completely overwhelmed by God. And so that I can't think or talk, just completely. So what do you think this is going to look like? And why hasn't it happened yet? Has anybody got an answer for that? See, I'm asking you questions. I like that. I think God's great. At any rate, I've been doing some studies lately, and I've been a musician since I can think, I think. And I've always loved music, but I really loved the sound of it and the frequencies that it occupies. Do you notice that? Does anybody feel that? I like the feel. I like what things like this make me feel like. Feel an energy, and something starts happening. You're like, I can feel this thing. This could take off, you know, because something is in it that God does, and there's clusters of sounds, and there's chord changes that have more worship in them than others. And those are three of the chords. Ones that they were doing today. You've heard that. 2 seconds, we can be in God's presence. Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's all it takes. And he's just all of a sudden, I hear my sound. I'm ready to come. I hear my words. I hear my sound. And all of a sudden, the room is flooded with this amazing thing called his presence. Why? Must be these chords. No, it's the broken heart of every human in here. It's that cry. It inhabits your praise. That's what he's doing. He's moving. Now, through the years, we've had a few little bumps in the get-along, but not until the last century was it like it is. Now, I try to explain this, and I'll do this really quickly and make sense to you. It'll get a little bit technical, but it's okay. You'll get over it. He said that we were to offer praise unto him, and all of creation is groaning, waiting for you and I to recognize we are sons of the living God. All of creation is still groaning, even as I sit here today. It's out there, wake up, wake up, wake up. We got trees ready to clap their hands when they hear the praises of the children. We have trees ready to release the healing of the nations through the leaves. Isn't that interesting? That's in Revelation. Why isn't it being released? Why hasn't it happened? And so I began to investigate this, and the Lord began to show me something. This is A432. Standard is 440. Every instrument here is tuned to 440. This guitar is tuned to 432. Isn't that interesting? Which was the standard before 1950 in the United States. It began in 1918, I'll tell you quickly, when people discovered that higher frequencies overwhelmed or overshadowed lower frequencies. This is a frequency. When we hear higher ones, lower ones, this is higher. Higher frequencies always overshadow lower frequencies. It's the standard that they discovered. They began to use it as a part of healing because frequencies heal the human body. It was discovered in 1920 by a man named Rife, R-I-F-F. He had 100% success healing terminal cancer with just merely playing frequencies for the person who was dying. Just to give you a little hint. Why? Because God gave that as an understanding to us as a people. By the 30s, or actually later in the 20s, his research was stopped, and he disappeared, and all of his research was taken. Now it's resurfacing. Does anybody know that? That research is resurfacing. So he got everybody curious on what frequencies really mean. Why do they mean certain things? And by the mid-30s, they began to find out that the 440 frequency of A, this being 440 and not 432, would actually create antisocial behavior. So all the instruments by 1939 were tuned up to 440 instead of 432. All the music played in Nazi Germany was 440, and it was used to control the people by creating antisocial behavior. Interesting, don't you think? The very thing that God would inhabit, the very power of praise in our hands and in our mouths, was perverted into a higher pitch. I want you to be reminded, anointing is not affected by this because God is alive. Our God is alive, by the way. But if you didn't get that, he is alive. He's not a stone. He's not a statue. He's alive. That means you can whistle half decent and praise can break out. So it doesn't really, to God, it is not relevant to him. It's relevant to us. And it's relevant to the planet that we live on. Do you understand that? So I'm not saying that you haven't had anointed worship, and today proved it, obviously. So his presence is not stuck on 440 or 432. His presence is his presence because he is an amazing God. Now, what we haven't been taking advantage of is what these other frequencies might have done for us. So I get this really quickly. By 1950, the United States adopted 440 as our standard pitch. A440 means everything is tuned to that pitch. And everything is divisible according to that. That turned out to be the antisocial behavior. By 1955, rock and roll started. And we also began the biggest rebellion that's ever been in this world. And we blamed it on a music style, never thinking that it was the tuning of the instruments that caused us to be so irritated by it. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Now, when we're really young, most young people have no idea. They've only heard 440 all of their lives. They've never heard anything different. So there's nothing to compare it to. So, it's fine. It works fine. I mean, play the guitar, it works fine. All the instruments are tuned to 440. What's the problem? Except the name of 440 tuning is Luciferic Brightness. That's the name of it. So it was done deliberately. The name of 432 tuning is called Christ-centered. That's the technical name. Is that the craziest thing you ever heard of in your life? That made me crazy when I heard this. So I just said, what happens if we tune down? It's very little difference between 440 and 432. Just enough. There's just enough difference so that none of the frequencies that we play affect the human body. Because in 432, these keys affect your body. Isn't that strange? What if the last 40 years, or 50 or more, what if we had been playing worship in 432? How many bodies might have been healed during those times? Unconsciously. How much of nature would have been joining us in our shouts of praise if they could hear it? You ever notice if you're playing, I say this to musicians, we're playing along and then the crowd is loving it. They're singing the praises to the Lord. The band stops and the people keep singing. Did you notice that? They keep singing. They worship God. And in a few seconds, they go down in pitch and they're below the band. When the band starts playing again, they're flat to the band. They have automatically transferred down to 432 because every one of us live on 432. And you have to fight your ears to push it back up to 440. You have to fight yourself because it's the most unnatural thing for your body to accept. You will sing instantly in 432 if just let alone to do it by yourself. No matter how much we've heard 440, you still will drop to 432. After all these years, nothing has changed the way the human being hears sound. Did you ever watch a dog lay in front of the record player when it's too loud? They don't even move because it's not affecting them at all. I tuned my guitar down to 432 and our cat went nuts. It came running down the stairs. What are you doing? You know, and I'm just playing in the, sitting in the kitchen playing, and the cat's staring at me with this look. And I thought, good Lord, what happened to the cat? You know? And suddenly you realize there's a change that's starting to break out. Now, the enemy used a 440 intonation to drive a nation, drive a whole country into rebellion against Father and Son. Is that correct? Is that where the generation gap began? It was right there, right in the 50s. By the 60s, and this is not very good news, but by the 60s, the suicide rate in young people had reached almost epidemic proportions. By the 70s, it was outrageous how many young people were taking their own lives. By the mid-80s, that was replaced with young people shooting each other. They began to just shoot each other. Do you think there's something wrong in the sound that we're listening to? And more music is in the hearts of more young people. More deeper are they. And they've, you know, got your headphones on and you're buried in it. And every ounce of it is done in 440. And it's just driving you into antisocial behavior and we don't even know it. Does that make sense? So we come to church and we worship God. It's like an amazing relief, isn't it? I mean, no matter what frequency we're in, it's just a relief to feel Him moving among us. But how hard is it to talk your children into sitting with you and hearing those sounds together? Very difficult, isn't it? Does anybody have that problem? We do back east. You know, the kids don't. They're just like, oh, I don't want to play your old man music. Isn't it true? And it's true. I mean, I understand all that. You know, and the kids have got sound, their own sound, and it's the way they want to be. I don't, you know, it's great. I don't think there's anything wrong with the style. There's just a lot wrong with the frequency that it's coming from. So, Then we entered, and I'm doing this real fast, we entered into the digital age. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody here old enough to have played a record? Anybody? Yeah. A record has a frequency response as high as 100,000 cycles. Our ears can only hear around 15,000 when you're a kid, 12,000 when you get older, 10,000 when you get older, and lower. And so what's the point? Why do you need to hear 100,000? Why do you need to hear 50,000? Because the breath of God is in the high frequencies. It's called the breath of the music, literally, in recording terms. They call it the breath. And because it's so high, you can discern what the music, what the heart of the music is. Do you understand that? When digital began, they filtered all music at 20,000. Nothing is above 20,000, which is where the Spirit speaks. How do you think the Spirit speaks to you? If he doesn't move through the air, if he isn't in the wind like scriptures say he is, it's the breath of God that we hear, that we hear it in music. And because my ears won't hear it, my face, my chest, my teeth hear 50, 60,000. That's how we hear in the Spirit. It comes right through your face. Did you know that? Sorry. I don't want to get technical. But that's where it comes from. And so when I hear a song, when we're in this room, all the frequencies are wide open and moving in the room because there's nothing stopping it. There's no filter on this. So we feel the presence and we hear the Spirit, and it's going right into your heart, your face, and your spirit, and your ears. Your ears are only a part of it. You understand that? And if you start to hear stuff in the Spirit, it's actually entered right into your face and moved right into your heart. So the vibration of it is very key. And so if that gets out of sync, we're in trouble. Is that making sense? So the beginning of the digital age was the 80s, late 80s, and we've not gone back since. Now the Lord is bringing a change in this. I'll give you this word really fast, and then we can stop. Bob Jones, do you guys know Bob Jones, the prophetic guy? Died here only February. And he stopped me one day, and we've talked a lot, and he stopped me one day only a few months ago. And he said, I had a dream, and I saw a man falling out of heaven, and his body was made out of instruments. And he was coming to steal the heart of a generation. I said, oh, wow, what do you want me to do about that? And he said, you've got to find an antidote for that. And I said, I don't know how to do that. And he said, you will. And the Lord began to show me that we have been playing in the wrong frequencies. Now, this is no shame. And again, this does not affect the anointing. Don't go burning all your CDs. This does not affect the presence of God, because God is real and alive. And so that you know this, CDs are not anointed. The life of the person who made it is anointed. So this is just a piece of plastic. But the life of the person, if they stay tuned with God, that CD will remain anointed for all time. If they fall away from God, the CD will lose interest, and you will go, gee, that doesn't sound as good as it used to. And it doesn't have an anointing anymore. So that means the anointing is alive and it works based on one thing, God alone. It's him. So don't get scared about the music you have. Nothing in the world is wrong with it. If you sense an anointing, it's because it is. Because God is still blessing the life. Now he's changing the frequencies because he wants to incorporate all of the earth to join us in this next battle. Am I making sense? Yeah. And just like it was spoken earlier, this next battle will be in praise. There'll be a fight to stop it, but it's too late. That fight's too late. The enemy cannot stop what God is up to. And Isaiah 14 is coming to pass when the enemy and the sound of his harp will be brought to the grave, down to Sheol, and be covered with maggots and worms. That's what it says, Isaiah 14. The sound of his harps. That means music is what he wants to use to steal this next generation. But God is way out ahead of this. And he is beginning to not just steal the hearts of man. He's stealing entire generations. And he's using nature. He's using you. He's using me. He's using the sound of the instrument to heal and to bring change into our lives. The change we keep crying for and need is waiting in the sound of our praise. That makes sense? There's way more to this subject, but it's important not to wear you out with too many details. Why would God do this? And why would he do it now? Why is he releasing this information now? Why didn't he tell us about 440 and 432 in 1960 when we started losing our youth? Why did he wait till 2010 or so when I first heard this? It is because now is the time that God's taking the earth by overwhelming it with the sound of his praise. He said to me, I asked God, I said, what would it take to change the body of Christ to be fully tuned towards you, Lord? He said, it would take 1,000 years. I said, oh, boy, I don't know. I don't think I can wait that long. And he said, yeah, but 1,000 years to me is a day. And in Psalm 91, it says, for 1,000 years in your presence can pass like one watch of the night. That means in a 3-hour period in the middle of the night, one night, God's going to change the entire body of Christ as if it had been through 1,000 years of change. He's going to do it in one night. And it's going to happen from those who understand that wake-up call that they get at 4:44. Anybody have that wake-up call? Anybody? Anybody wake up at 3 a.m.? Got any 3 a.m.ers? That's the watch of the night that he's going to break into. And when he does, our whole body will change. There'll be more than a revival for the word. There'll be an absolute famine for the word of God. And it will break into the hearts of those who believe, and they will go beyond all measure to pull to themselves the word of God, embrace it, and then begin to sing, I love your word, O God. Does that not say it in Scripture? I love you, and I love your word. I love your law. Here's David saying, this law is harder than I can handle, but I love your law. I love your word in me, God, and I want it to come out of my mouth. I want my voice to sing it. I want my spirit to shout it, and I want my life to be the obedience to the word of the living God, just like David said it. And it's not going away. Jesus fulfilled it completely. He didn't do away with it. He completely fulfilled it, and so will we. You okay?
Yes.
All right. I'm out. Love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you may it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Sing it with me. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to take joy, my King, in what you hear.
awesome name. We'll watch our young ones fall on the face and cry out, Jesus is my Lord. And when the lost come into your house, they'll hear the praises of God breaking out, and they'll say, truly God is among you, truly God is among you. And we praise, glory to your name, blessed be the name of my Lord, blessed be the name of my Lord.
You can investigate these things for yourself. You can find it even online, amazingly. You will also run into New Age websites that have discovered 432 heals the body. If New Age stuff bothers you, I wouldn't suggest going on there and checking it out. But if you can lose your salvation that easy, then maybe you need to come and talk to the pastor again about your salvation. If it's all it takes is to investigate a New Age website to mess with your salvation, I don't think that's possible. Do you understand me? That isn't possible for somebody who loves the Lord. So if you want to look into this further, look past, because there are many Christian sites that are beginning to share this and beginning to share a lot about it. There's a Christian guy who is a scientist, and he's discovered much, much more than I've just said about the healing qualities of the frequency response that's coming from the heavens. And when the harp players begin to play in the heavens, when the bowls of incense are filled, they play the sound that's coming from their bowls. They play that sound, and there's 24, which means there's 24 notes, which means there's two octaves takes 24 notes of our octaves. It takes eight notes in a scale and takes 12 to complete one. There's 12 notes. And so it takes 12, and two octaves is 24. So the Lord knew what he was doing way out ahead of us. And what we're really looking for is the sound from heaven to resonate on the earth. And when we begin to play what we hear from heaven in the same frequency that it's sent to us, that is, in fact, the answer to your prayer. Did you know that? There's many more prayers that have already been answered that we don't even know about because we have been listening with the wrong frequencies. We're not wrong. We're right with God. Again, don't be afraid that all of this is a mess. It's not a mess. It's just about to get a lot, lot better. So I bless you in the name of Jesus and pray over your musicians now in the name of Jesus that the fire of God would never be quenched in the hearts of everyone who ever passes across this stage, that your heart...